The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on update on refugees from Ukraine. Before I call on the First Minister to deliver the statement, I invite members to join me in welcoming to the gallery Yevhen Mankovsky, the Consul of Ukraine. I would remind members that the First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I now call on Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister.
Presiding Officer, Russia's illegal invasion of Ukraine is causing the largest displacement of people in Europe since World War II, and of course in a much shorter timescale. The UN has estimated that over 3 million people, over 5% of Ukraine's total population, have already left the country. Those fleeing, overwhelmingly women and children, are leaving their homes in circumstances which, however hard we might try, are impossible for us to truly imagine. They deserve, need and must receive compassion, care and support. Countries across Europe are confronting this humanitarian emergency. It is estimated that 1.8 million people have arrived in Poland, 250,000 in Hungary, and 80,000 in Moldova, which has a population of just 4 million. Many of us were moved last week by scenes in Berlin of German families flocking to the railway station to offer shelter and support for those arriving from Ukraine. However, even as we are moved and inspired by such scenes of compassion, we continue to be deeply shocked that this is happening at all. Just 3 weeks ago, the world still hoped that there would be no invasion. People in Ukraine were still going to work, school and university. They were living normal lives. Today, those lives have been ripped apart. More than 3 million are displaced. Thousands more are fighting on front lines. Many have been killed. And an entire population is showing incredible courage and resistance. All of that, of course, is down to the evil, and I am using that word deliberately, of one man, Vladimir Putin. Scotland stands firmly with all governments, including, of course, the UK, in condemning Putin's war crimes, taking action to isolate and penalise his regime, and doing everything possible to support the people of Ukraine. The Scottish Government is committed to playing our full part in the international effort to help those displaced as a result of the war. Other countries, of course, have waived the requirement for people from Ukraine to obtain visas in order to gain entry and settle. The strong preference of the Scottish Government is for the UK to adopt the same approach. However, while we will continue to press for this, we will also work with UK ministers to make the processes they have put in place as effective as possible. And that is the focus of my statement today. At present, people from Ukraine can enter the UK through the family scheme. I hope the changes announced to it last week will make it easier and quicker than it has been so far. A second route, Homes for Ukraine, was announced this week. In time, it is hoped that very significant numbers of Ukrainians will come to the UK through this scheme. The fact that more than 100,000 people across the UK have already signed up to offer accommodation demonstrates the willingness of the public to help, and the response so far has been magnificent. The terms of the scheme, though, mean that it will take time for this outpouring of support to translate into large numbers of people from Ukraine actually able to come to the UK. The first phase of the scheme depends on matches being made between refugees and individual sponsors, and initially it is only those who already have or can themselves find details of people seeking refuge who will be able to provide help quickly. The Scottish Government's proposal seeks to short-circuit that process. We want to have offered to act as a single super sponsor to allow significant numbers of people fleeing Ukraine to come to Scotland immediately. We have offered to sponsor 3,000 straight away. Longer term, we have given an uncapped commitment to support at least 10% of the total number who seek sanctuary in the UK. In practice, Scottish Government sponsorship would mean that people from Ukraine do not need to be matched with individual sponsors before being allowed entry to the UK. They would be able to come here to sanctuary and safety first. We will provide temporary accommodation, and then with people already safely here, and I am sure wrapped in a warm Scottish welcome, we will work at speed with partners, local councils, the Scottish Refugee Council, the NHS, Disclosure Scotland and others to complete safeguarding checks, put in place wider health, education, practical and befriending support and arrange longer-term accommodation. Now, we warmly welcome and intend to fully harness the thousands of individual offers from people willing to provide refugees with a home. I want to thank everyone who has volunteered. Of course, not everyone will be in a position to offer accommodation, but there will be many other ways for people to offer support. However, welcome and necessary though the voluntary offers of accommodation are, we must be mindful that those fleeing the war may need to be here for a long time. They will wish, as we all wish for them, to return to Ukraine as soon as possible and for Scotland to be just a temporary home. But unfortunately, they may need to be here for longer than we can reasonably expect members of the public to provide accommodation. So as well as fully harnessing the goodwill of people across Scotland, we also need to plan for long-term sustainable accommodation and ensure appropriate public service provision, and I'll say more about that shortly. Firstly, though, let me underline the immediacy of the preparations we are making. As I indicated yesterday, the UK Government has given in-principle support to the super-sponsor proposal. We are now working to agree as quickly as possible the operational detail. Our aim is that our super-sponsor route will run in parallel with the first phase of the wider UK scheme. That should make it possible, and this is certainly our hope, for the first 3,000 displaced Ukrainians to begin arriving in Scotland from as early as this weekend. Now, I need to be clear that this is dependent on UK Government agreement. Only the Home Office can issue the visas. But there is no good reason, in my view, for this agreement not to be reached. We hope and expect that it will be, and crucially, this is the basis on which we are now planning. Detailed preparations are being led by Neil Gray as Minister with special responsibility for coordinating this response. They cover five priorities: ensuring we get the data we need from UK Government systems, making contact with those coming to Scotland, securing short-term accommodation for those who need it, working on longer-term support, including housing and community integration, and finally establishing welcome hubs over the coming days. And I'll say a bit more on each of these and on resources to support delivery. We're working closely with local authorities, other public sector agencies, Disclosure Scotland, for example, the third sector and the UK Government on the practical issues that need to be addressed to ensure the process operates smoothly. For example, urgent work is underway to ensure the sharing of data from UK Government systems, including from the visa application system. That information will allow us to better and more quickly understand who is coming here and what needs they might have. We're also exploring how we can start making support available even before people get here, help with travel, for example. And obviously, as a matter of priority, we're working to secure immediate temporary accommodation that is safe and comfortable for people while longer-term arrangements are put in place. In addition to harnessing voluntary support, we are assessing other longer-term housing options. This will include, where available, local authority and housing association properties, but also private sector or holiday accommodation. And finally, we are establishing with a range of partners, including local authorities, the police, health services and the Scottish Refugee Council, welcome hubs to offer practical help and assistance, for example, with food, clothing, healthcare, language support and signposting to other services. Decisions on exactly where these hubs will be located will firm up as we develop a better understanding of when and exactly where people will arrive. We have considered the resources necessary to support this work in the first instance. I can confirm that, in addition to financial support the UK Government will provide, the Scottish Government is allocating £15 million to support our immediate response. Just over £11 million of this will be allocated to local authorities, £2.25 million will be set aside for temporary accommodation, and a further £1.4 million is being allocated to the Scottish Refugee Council for the expansion of the Refugee Integration Service. I visited the Scottish Refugee Council earlier today to discuss their invaluable contribution to Scotland's response to the Ukraine crisis and to thank them for their wider work to support refugees and asylum seekers. Presiding Officer, I think it's important for me to be clear to Parliament that the challenges of resettling thousands of displaced and traumatised people in such a short space of time are significant and they should not be underestimated. Given the sheer pace at which everyone is working and, of course, the need to agree the operational arrangements with the UK Government, not every question of detail yet has a definite answer. Meeting the challenge will require effective and ongoing cooperation between the Scottish and UK governments and councils, with and across the wider public and third sectors, and with many other partners and local communities. Parliament also has a vital part to play. As MSPs, we often gain a unique insight into the quality of support provided on the ground and can be instrumental in making sure problems are identified and quickly addressed. But for all the undoubted challenges, I am confident that Scotland will live up to our humanitarian obligations. We have very recent experience of successfully integrating refugees into our communities, schools and workplaces. And I'm confident that we will provide not just refuge, but a warm welcome and a helping hand to people whose lives have been ripped apart. We will open our doors and we will also open our hearts. The duty of government is to ensure that the practical assistance we provide matches the warmth and goodwill of people across the country. We have an obligation to play our full part in the global humanitarian effort and offer sanctuary, security and a home to thousands of people who desperately need it. I know these aims are shared across Parliament. So let's all of us work together as we stand in resolute solidarity with the people of Ukraine in this hour of need.
Thank you, First Minister. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement, and I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we will move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if those members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Donald Cameron.
Can I thank the First Minister for advance sight of her statement and associate these benches with the sentiments expressed towards the people of Ukraine and her recognition of the compassion of those here in Scotland who have volunteered to help. Needless to say, we continue to condemn the abhorrent violence that the Putin regime is inflicting on Ukraine and its people. Providing a place of refuge and sanctuary for those fleeing violence is a tradition that belongs to no one country or nation, but arises from the instinct in us all to ensure the dignity of every human being in need of safety and protection. In that spirit, it is very welcome that the Scottish and UK governments are working collaboratively to ensure that in Scotland we can provide that place of refuge, and I appreciate the additional detail we have just been given. Can I ask, firstly, given that many refugees may struggle with English and in any event will be arriving in a new place, what plans does the Scottish Government have to ensure they are provided with clear information about how to access vital public services? And, in particular, will any assistance be provided to new arrivals to allow them to register quickly with the GP so they can have full access to healthcare, particularly if language is a possible barrier?
First Minister.
Can I thank Donald Cameron for his support, for his comments and also for his questions. I referred in my statement to the work being done with our partners right now to establish welcome hubs. These will be arrangements that are in place to offer immediate practical advice, assistance and support to people arriving. I hope members will understand that while we are seeking through our work with the UK Government to understand exactly when and where people will arrive, we cannot yet finalise the precise location of these hubs, but that work is under consideration and those decisions will be taken quickly as soon as possible. They will offer, and multi-agency teams are already working to support this, they will offer, for example, welcome packs and information leaflets that will be translated into Ukrainian, and these will offer information about how to access broader support, including social security benefits, which will be important. Translators will be on hand to help. The provision of language support, of course, will be a longer-term ongoing requirement, which we are also considering. Part of that welcome hub approach will be also to signpost people to healthcare services, including how they register with GPs, and this issue was raised in Parliament with me yesterday. We are paying particular attention and taking advice from Public Health Scotland and the Chief Medical Officer about what support will be offered in the context of COVID as well, vaccination, for example, for people who haven't had that. So that will all be part of the initial arrangements that are in place to welcome and support people. Much of that will have to continue on a longer term and more sustainable basis. But these are the arrangements that are being worked on literally as we speak here in Parliament.
I call Jackie Bailey.
Presiding Officer, we all stand in solidarity with the people of Ukraine as they resist the unprovoked and unjustified attack on their country by Vladimir Putin. The UK government has been slow in response to the refugee crisis, and I hope that they do waive the bureaucratic visa requirements. But there are 5,000 Ukrainians settled in Scotland, at least another 6,000 are seasonal workers, so it is clear to me that the SNP government will need to offer more than the 3,000 places. The overriding concern is that we move at pace to help with the rapidly unfolding humanitarian crisis. We have all been overwhelmed by the generosity of people in our constituencies and indeed across Scotland who want to help, whether that's through overseas aid donations or offering homes, rooms in their homes for refugees. So can the First Minister indicate whether people should register with the UK Homes for Ukraine website, or is there another route to do so in Scotland? Can I also ask the First Minister, what are the plans to quickly vet the properties and potential hosts for refugees? What are the plans to provide wraparound services, including education and, of course, childcare, to enable parents to work? And what are the plans for health services? Because given the trauma people have experienced, mental health support will be critical. But we know that CAMHS is already under huge pressure and experiencing long waiting times. So can I ask the First Minister, how much will be allocated to mental health? How much it expects to be allocated by the UK government? And when additional resources will be made available to local government who stepped up to the plate in the past to help Syrian refugees and are well placed to help people from Ukraine?
First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I mean, some of this information, of course, was provided in my statement. I'm happy to expand upon it. Let's take numbers. First of all, I was very careful to say in my statement that the commitment we have given to the flow of people from Ukraine through the Homes for Ukraine scheme and hopefully our super sponsor route is uncapped. 3,000 is an initial immediate commitment, and we hope that we will see people start to arrive under that as early as this weekend. We would anticipate at least 10% of the overall number coming to the UK, but we are not putting a cap on that. But I think the other point worth making is that that is an addition to people who will come through the family scheme and settle with families already here. I have already met with, last week and again this morning in Glasgow, members of the Ukrainian community here, many of them already going through the process of getting visas via the family scheme to have family members come here. So that is the scale of the commitment, and it would be wrong to misrepresent that as a fixed commitment of 3,000. I think everything I've said has been clear. That is not the case. Secondly, in terms of my advice to people in Scotland, yes, I would advise people who can offer accommodation to register their interest in through the UK government portal that was launched on Monday. We are one of the things we are working with the UK government on is how we then get that data, access that data in Scotland, so that we know who has volunteered in Scotland, that we get the data from the visa application process, so that we can then, once people are already here, make those matches here. In terms of disclosure checks, one of the agencies we're working closely with, again, I mentioned this in my statement, is Disclosure Scotland in terms of the checks on people volunteering that will be done, because safeguarding is a really important part of this. And finally, in terms of services, we obviously need to start planning now, and we are doing a huge amount of planning now, but we don't yet know exactly how many people will come to Scotland. And therefore, it would be wrong and inappropriate to put capped figures for financial support any more than capped figures for numbers of people. And that will apply to mental health support, to local government support. We will need to make sure that in addition to the tariff that has been agreed by the UK government, that's publicly available, the money that the Scottish government provides is commensurate to the scale of people coming here. But again, I have made an initial commitment, and I set this out in my statement of £15 million that we are making available as of today, in addition to UK government tariff resources, just over 11 million of that will be allocated to local authorities immediately. So we're working across a range of these things, but I think all members will appreciate that as we agree the operational details, as I hope we will, because this is still very much dependent on the UK government agreeing visas for people to come. As we agree that, as we know when, where and how many people arrive, we are going to have to continue to flex these arrangements to make sure that they are appropriate for the scale of the challenge and obligation that we are meeting.
I call Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Cocab Stewart.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I express the admiration and solidarity of the Scottish Liberal Democrats for the people of Ukraine and our utter condemnation of the war crimes of Vladimir Putin, Slava Ukraini. I welcome very much the announcement of the super sponsor scheme. And, Presiding Officer, we shouldn't be justifiably proud but not wholly surprised by the colossal response that we have seen, not just from the people in Scotland, but across Great Britain, opening their homes to Ukrainians fleeing conflict. These refugees will have been through the very worst in human suffering. They will require access to trauma recovery, long-term counselling, and, as I suggested yesterday, perhaps even immediate vaccination against COVID, should they wish it. They will all be vital. I'd be grateful for an update on or further detail on this. I'd also like to ask the First Minister about the Scottish Government's refugee integration strategy, the new Scot strategy. That runs up until the end of this year, so it's nearing the end of its life, and it's still struggling to deal with people from Afghanistan, which, lest we forget, was just 6 months ago. STV News revealed that as many as 300 Afghans remain in temporary and bridging accommodation in different parts of this country as work to resettle them continues. So can I ask the First Minister, what lessons have been learned from the failure to resettle those refugees from Afghanistan, and what changes can we make to ensure that similar backlogs do not occur with this scheme?
First Minister.
We're drawing heavily on experience through the previous refugee integration work, not just Afghanistan, and I don't think it's fair to describe this in terms of failure. There is an ongoing process to not just welcome people here, but to settle and to integrate them into our communities. But I think anybody looking fairly at, in particular, the response of the Scottish public, local authorities, other agencies, and the success of the work they did in supporting the Syrian resettlement scheme would know that we have a lot of very positive experience to draw on there. We want to see this work very much embedded in that new Scots strategy, and that's one of the things I was talking to the Scottish Refugee Council about this morning. The 3,000 figure that we have committed as an initial welcome to the UK government in terms of the super sponsor scheme, that hasn't been drawn from nowhere. 3,000 are the number of Syrian refugees that we were able to settle through that scheme. So we know we can relatively quickly, although this has been done much more quickly than with the Syrian scheme, we can make sure that we do that. But we'll be learning all of those lessons, the good ones, the more challenging ones as well. You know, this comes down to, there are lots of challenges here, and if we were simply to look at this as a challenge, we would sort of shy away from it. But this is a moral obligation that we, in common with countries across the world, have right now, a moral humanitarian obligation. I am not standing here suggesting that this will be easy or straightforward, that there will not be real difficulties and challenges, that we will not face hurdles along the way. But this is work that we have a duty to do, and it's work that with our partners we are focused on making sure we get right and put all of the practical arrangements in place as quickly as possible.
I call Cocab Stewart to be followed by Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is important that the Scottish Government ensures the fair and equitable treatment of all Ukrainian refugees, black and white, old and young. Can I ask the First Minister what discussions the Scottish Government has had with relevant partners regarding safeguarding issues related to the Homes for Ukraine scheme to ensure that all people, and in particular children and young people, are placed in safe and supportive environments?
First Minister.
Can I say, first of all, because I think Cocab Stewart makes an important point, that we are all, of course, horrified at what is happening in and to Ukraine right now, and we all desperately want to do everything we possibly can to help. But the duty to give refuge to people fleeing war or famine doesn't depend on where they come from or who they are, what religion or faith or culture they come from. That is a duty we all owe as a matter of humanity to everybody who needs it. And I do believe Scotland has a good record, notwithstanding the challenges that we know are involved in this, in terms of opening our doors and hearts to Syrian refugees, to Afghan refugees, but perhaps not just in the immediate response to those fleeing war in Ukraine. One of the lessons we can take from this is that we have that duty to open our hearts to people fleeing war from all parts of the world. In terms of safeguarding, the issue of safeguarding is central to all of the discussions we're having with partners. It is really important that as we harness the outpouring of support from the public, we do not neglect the well-being and the safety of those fleeing war and trauma. Obviously, the principal discussions we are having are with Disclosure Scotland to make sure we have the processes in place to quickly do appropriate checks. But I want to assure the Chamber that is a critical part of all of the work that we are doing as we seek to put in place the arrangements for immediate welcome, but then ensure that that support continues as people settle and integrate here. And that applies to accommodation, health services, wider support services, and that focus on wellbeing and safety as well.
I call Sharon Dowie, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the First Minister offer a guarantee that no Ukrainian refugee will find themselves in temporary accommodation for a period of longer than 1 month in order to minimise uncertainty for these individuals, many of whom have experienced high levels of stress and require a stable, integrated environment as soon as possible?
First Minister.
Well, our priority, first of all, and this is the whole intention of the super sponsor proposal, is to get people to sanctuary in Scotland as quickly as possible. Rather than having bureaucratic processes that take a long time while people are still in Poland or other countries to get them here, that will mean that because we then want to do the longer term matching process while people are in Scotland, that there will be a period in which we house them in temporary accommodation. There is work ongoing, again, literally as we speak, to secure temporary accommodation. In the short term, that is likely to be hotel accommodation, perhaps university accommodation. It will be our intention for that to be short term while the longer term support is put in place. But having people in that short term accommodation, I think, is preferable to them having to go through long standing bureaucratic processes just to get here in the first place. But speed of action here is what is really important. But speed of action underpinned by all the proper safeguarding and other processes that I think everybody has a right to expect. I think there is also a need to recognise that while we are hugely grateful for and must harness the public support and offers of accommodation, we shouldn't take that for granted, nor should we expect members of the public to shoulder a disproportionate part of this responsibility. People will be able to offer accommodation. Some people will be able to offer accommodation. Some people will be able to do it for longer than others. But if we are, and we all hope the war will end quickly and people will be able to go home as quickly as possible, but if people need to be here for a longer period of time, we must be thinking about the long-term sustainability of accommodation rather than expecting members of the public to perhaps make their homes available for very lengthy periods of time. So these are all things we're thinking about very carefully, but we're not just thinking about them, we're seeking to get on at pace and make sure we have these arrangements in place so that we can start welcoming people literally within days if the UK Government and the Home Office make it possible for us to do so.
Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Public opinion has now ensured that the UK Government will provide more assistance to refugees than it originally intended. Last August, 3,000 UK households volunteered to take Afghan refugees, but sadly not one has been progressed by Westminster. So does the First Minister agree that Scotland and Wales, by acting as super sponsors for the Ukrainian refugee scheme, will be able to avert further foot dragging by the UK Conservative Government?
First Minister.
Well, I know there have been considerable delays with the UK Government's matching process for Afghan families. Indeed, one of the reasons why initially we argued for the UK Government to take a different route than a community sponsorship route was that our experience has been that we managed to settle more people through the Syrian resettlement scheme than we have done through previous community sponsorship schemes. However, this is the route the UK Government have opted to take. They have simplified it and made the requirements less onerous than in previous schemes, and that is welcome. But we must continue to do everything we can to make it as effective and as efficient and as quick and safe and humane for people as possible. If we manage to, as I really hope we will, make a success of this super sponsor proposal, I think it may give us lessons for how we deal with humanitarian crises like this in future. And I hope the Home Office and the UK Government generally will be open, as we will be, to learning those lessons as we go.
Sarah Boyett, to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
First Minister, you mentioned the importance of the need to learn lessons from supporting people from Syria who've come to Scotland. Employability and welfare rights were mentioned by 78% of respondents in research. So what work is the Scottish Government doing now with employers to prepare them to offer jobs to Ukrainians coming to Scotland? And what work is the Scottish Government doing to support digital connectivity so that people can access welfare support, keep connected for learning, and enabling them to access support networks? The Ukrainian Consul General was clear in committee last week that many Ukrainians will want to return to Ukraine to rebuild their country, but we do not know how long that will take, given many of them have homes which no longer exist. So we need to see our businesses able to reach out to Ukrainians so their skills can be matched with potential employers so that they can support their families. So keen to hear what the First Minister is doing to make that a reality.
First Minister.
Well, I want to give an assurance to the Chamber that work across all of these issues is ongoing. I think members will understand that the principal and immediate focus is on making the arrangements and getting the agreements to get people here, to put immediate support in place for them, to accommodate them with health services and other support in place very quickly. But already we are thinking about employability. We have businesses and sectors that are already making offers of employment and accommodation support. Remember, we need people to come here and work across a range of sectors, so we are already seeking to collate and coordinate that. There will be requirements to help people who perhaps have qualifications in Ukraine adapt those qualifications here. Now, I can't give commitments right now, but this is work we are exploring. If somebody has qualifications in healthcare or in teaching, for example, are we able to allow them, support them to quickly make those skills available here? So that is all work that is underway. Similarly, in digital connectivity, a big part of this is making sure we use all the systems that are there to speed up this work. So all of this is underway. Some of it will take longer to get in place than other parts of it, because that immediate focus is what is most important. But all of this is part of a very rapid and comprehensive. The reason we are working and want to do this through the super sponsor route is so that we can do this much more comprehensively, have a greater visibility of how many people are here, where they're going to be, what skills they bring that allow us to do this in a holistic way. So we will keep Parliament updated as this develops. We've referred to the Syrian precedent before. It's worth remembering that we had months to prepare for the Syrian resettlement scheme. We are doing this literally in a matter of days. So I can't answer every single question in detail right now, but I can give an assurance that all of these questions are being considered and we are working at pace to put the answers and the arrangements in place.
Colette Stevenson, who's joining us remotely, to be followed by Ros Grier.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Following contact from a constituent in East Kilbride who's waiting on extended family to arrive from Ukraine, the First Minister set out how the Scottish Government is working with stakeholders such as local authorities and the Scottish Refugee Council to ensure accommodation is available for people on arrival. Furthermore, what organisation is best placed to help people with disabilities requiring accommodation?
First Minister.
I think these are important questions. Most of my comments today in my statement and in the answers I've been given to questions have been about the people who will come through the Homes for Ukraine route and hopefully the super sponsor route that will run in parallel to that in relation to Scotland. But it's important to say that we are also standing ready to provide support to those coming through the family route. Many of them will not need accommodation because they will be coming to stay with family, but they may need help when they get here, travelling to their destination. They will need help in accessing other services. So we're seeking to put that in place. We have been trying over the past week or so to keep track of people who might be coming into the country already, whether that is people coming into Ciarán Ryan from Ireland, because obviously the Republic of Ireland has waived visa requirements, or whether it's people coming in through the family route to airports. Speaking, as I've said already, to the Scottish Refugee Council this morning, they had people at Edinburgh Airport at the weekend just to see, with boards saying, if you're coming from Ukraine, we're here to welcome you and support you. So some of this is happening already, and we need to make sure it continues to happen. The accommodation is obviously the critical, most immediate issue for people coming who don't have family accommodation. Getting that temporary accommodation in place and then working through those longer term options is definitely at the top of the priority list in terms of the various issues we are working through.
Okay, can I say, we have four more members seeking to ask a question. I'm keen to take each of them, but in order to do so, I will need to have succinct questions and answers. Ross Greer to be followed by Alistair Allen.
Thank you. Across the EU, we've seen incredible solidarity from bus and rail operators providing free transport to those fleeing the conflict in Ukraine. From Deutsche Bahn in Germany, the SNCF in France, and ferry operators in Sweden, countries and companies have stepped up to provide free, safe travel for refugees. Does the First Minister agree that both the UK and Scottish governments, as well as transport providers themselves, should join our European neighbours to do similar and help all those seeking refuge here, including those from the devastating war in Ukraine, by offering the widest possible free access scheme to public transport?
First Minister.
Yes, I do, and we will seek to reach out to transport providers to make sure that is the case. Obviously, Ross Greer is rightly talking about transport and travel within Scotland, but we have already had very tentative discussions exploring the possibility, should people who are in Poland and seeking and get agreement to come to Scotland, whether we can arrange travel for them to Scotland as well. So all of that is very much in the ambit of what we are looking at. Not all of these bits of support will be necessary for everybody, but we want to make sure that the support we are able to provide is as comprehensive and all-encompassing as it can be.
Alistair Allen, to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
I imagine almost every member in this chamber has been contacted, as I have, by constituents reaching out to offer their support to welcome Ukrainians to Scotland. Is the First Minister confident that the rollout of the super sponsor scheme can fully utilise and coordinate this outpouring of generosity, particularly among Scots who are unsure how to proceed when they have a room to offer but as yet no name of a person to offer it to?
First Minister.
Yes, I am confident that we can, through this scheme, match the generosity of the Scottish public. Just to be clear again about what we are effectively asking the UK Government to do, is to, from Friday, when I understand visas will start to be issued under the Homes for Ukraine scheme, is effectively issue 3,000 visas to people because we've said we'll sponsor them. So not demand that these people have individual sponsors identified in Scotland, but to allow the Scottish Government to be that single sponsor, let people come to Scotland, and then we will put in place the temporary accommodation while we do that matching process with people safely here. I believe, through all the work we're doing, we have operational meetings ongoing while we speak here in Parliament right now. I believe if we get that agreement from the UK Government, then we can put in place the arrangements to give people 3,000 initially and more than that beyond that, that safe sanctuary that they need here. What we need, though, is the UK Government able and willing to start to issue those visas from this weekend. That's the bit I hope we are going to get agreement on. I'm optimistic about that, but that is the bit we still need to secure.
Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, President Officer. First Minister, 2 weeks ago, a couple arrived from Ukraine having faced the trauma of travel. They were turned down for temporary accommodation because they weren't willing to give up one of their cats who they brought with them. Would the First Minister agree with me that there needs to be some pragmatism from local authorities when people come through horrific situations to allow them to have things that they've brought with them to take to that accommodation, whether that's pets or other things? And would you agree with me that there is a lack of accommodation here within the city, and will people that arrive in Edinburgh go to other parts of the country, or does she see Edinburgh becoming a major hub?
First Minister.
The experience of the Syrian resettlement scheme, of course, is that many different parts of Scotland, rural, remote, island communities, all played their part in welcoming people, and I think that's what we want to see here. Obviously, one of the issues of discussion that we're in with the UK Government right now is if this single super sponsor proposal is given the practical green light to get a sense of exactly where people will arrive. Will they all arrive into Edinburgh Airport? Will some come via London or other points of entry? They sound points of detail. They are points of detail, but they're really important points of detail to know where we put the you know, initial welcome hubs, and then where we immediately accommodate people temporarily while we do that wider matching. The point about pets is an important one. People are fleeing trauma. Not everybody offering accommodation will be willing to take a pet along with a pet. But this is part of the more information and visibility we have of people coming here, the more able we are to assess their needs and to properly match those needs with people willing to offer help here. So the super sponsor proposal is partly, and I'll be perfectly frank about this, it's partly about short-circuiting UK processes that I still think, and I have to say this, are too bureaucratic, too cumbersome, and are taking too long. But it is also about allowing us to offer more comprehensive support by having greater information about people who are coming here. That's why I really hope it works. And if it does, I am confident that the Scottish Government, working with our partners and with that great body of goodwill from across Scotland, will make Scotland a place of safety, sanctuary and welcome for as many Ukrainians as possible.
And briefly, please, Christine Graham.
Thank you. I note the proposal for welcome hubs and, if necessary, temporary accommodation. Can I suggest the Scottish Government could start by utilising premises in its ownership for welcome hubs and that accommodation? In Edinburgh, for example, we have Holyrood Palace, a stone's throw from here. It's owned, I understand, by the Scottish Government. It has lots of space, over 200 rooms, and is largely under-occupied.
First Minister.
I think... I'm very keen that we keep our focus on what we're trying to do to help Ukrainians. I know it's a serious, and I'm taking it seriously. I'm just a little bit reluctant to give an answer here that perhaps might generate a headline that detracts from the really important work we're doing. But Christine Graham's general point is right. We should be looking to utilise all possible ways of helping accommodate people in Ukraine. We're all being asked right now if we will do it. Everybody's circumstances are different. But her general point is absolutely right, that all accommodation that we can make available reasonably, we should do that. And that will allow us to ensure that we maximise the contribution that we are making.
Thank you, First Minister. And that concludes the statement. And there will be a very short pause to allow front bench teams to change over for the next item of business. Thank you.